gentle viewers, it's time for another episode in my vintage series. And in this one, I'll be showcasing three items, two of which are vintage finds, and one is brand new, but does fit within the theme. And I guess technically, I could say I have three vintage things to show you, as this background is actually a vintage dress. So today we're going to touch a little bit on the late 40s and 50s and my favorite design style, which is mid-century modern. So let's take a look. First piece. So if you have watched some of my vintage series videos before, you will know of my love for vintage glass. Now this piece is what's called a swung vase. And I just love the watery colors. It goes from dark blue to green and lighter blue. And a very pale green. And again, these were quite popular in the early 60s, and they still make them today. And you can actually Google how they make these, or heck, why don't you go onto YouTube? Now, like most blown glass, it starts its life in a kiln to make the glass molten. And as the glass blower is using his glass, I don't know the technical term, but the long pipe to blow the shape, they also take that metal pipe, again with the warm, well, it's not warm, it's very hot glass at the end, and they swing it. And it's that motion that creates that elongated shape. And again, they start to manipulate it to get that curve. And I love how it sounds different. the glass gets thinner. And the other gorgeous thing about this is you will see some air bubbles in the glass. And this particular shape, oh, little cat hair. This, again, this particular shape is really good for really long, sort of floppy blossoms and stems. So gladiolas, tulips, any of those more delicate top heavy blossoms or blooms, they look gorgeous in here. Now I am recording this in July, so most of my rose bushes are on their second bloom. And it's been very hot. Very, very hot. So my garden's looking a little bit parched. So perhaps I will later try to find some flowers to go in here. What's interesting with this one, all the little scallops have been separated except for right here. With the glass, there's just a little bit of a connection there with the glass. But again, you can see that. This is a really lovely find. Again, picked up at a garage sale. And I can tell you that when the light shines through this, even when it's empty, it's such a beautiful thing to behold. Lovely with our retro fabric. Now this next item I purchased because I thought it was rather unique. But I also wanted to have something to show that appeals more to the gentlemen, gentle viewer. So we'll just put this aside. So here is the next item. That I picked up at a garage sale. And it is a leather travel case. And because it still has its maker's mark on the objects inside, I could trace it back to the late 40s. And I think it is kind of funny that, again, this is used for travel. And you all know, as an introvert, I don't travel. But it was so beautifully made. And again, I wanted to showcase things that, occasionally, I would have wanted to showcase things that aren't necessarily my girly aesthetic. So I think what I'll do is bring you in a little closer so that when I open it you can take a good look. And of course on the front, you're probably open. Of course you already know what it is. We have the words whiskey, gin, and cognac. Now, I always like to make up stories about objects. And with this one, I always imagine that this was owned by a gentleman. And he was traveling on the Orient Express. And he brought his own private reserve of very expensive liquor. And he would be entertaining his guests in his private train compartment. And it has a zipper, so we'll just open that up. And I actually display it open like this. And please don't be disappointed, but the bottles are empty. But look at how they're shaped. And they are quite a snug fit. There's one, two, and then three. Just put this off to the side. I guess I could fill these with colored water and just have them sitting in front of the case. And on the top, it still has the sticker, and it says made in Italy. And then it has another cap, because of course you don't want your precious liquor spilling on the train. So if you had to make up a story about who owned these and why, what would it be? Or would this person maybe take this when they went to a hunting lodge, or did they like to take this when they went out, when they were staying in their country estate, and perhaps went on an extravagant picnic after a walk through the woods? Now, I have seen other ones that the bottles were all the same shape. And I mean, I saw them online when I was doing some research. Oh, and I thought, these would also be really pretty. Sorry, gentlemen. These would be really pretty on a bathroom vanity. Maybe filled with bubble bath. That's a bit squeaky. Or maybe like a floral water. Toner. Somehow with me it always comes back to skincare. Now I'll just move these out of the way so that we can take a little closer look at the case. I just love how those just snug up together. And the leather is actually in quite good condition. It's just on the bottom. It just says Italian style, genuine leather, made in Italy. to hear your stories on what you think this would have been, or who would have owned this, and what he or she would have taken this travel case to. And what I find interesting about collecting things that were made in the 60s and backwards is the quality that we have become a society that is used to buying cheap products, cheaply made, that are meant not to last. And when they wear out or break, we just throw them in the landfill and buy something new. So again, even though I won't use this for its intended purpose, I can still admire the craftsmanship, the age that it is, and how well it has gone through the decades. And again, when I purchase things, it's usually because when I see them, I get this immediate reaction. It's usually one of either excitement or awe. Again, this isn't typical of what I am attracted to, but when I saw it, and it was a whole $7. Actually, it was less than that because the gentleman didn't have change. So I actually got it for $6. So let's put the bottles back. And then we can look at our final item, which again I mentioned is new, but does fit in with the theme. Close it up. Now this is the item I was talking about being the new, old, or vintage piece I wanted to show you. And it is a coffee table book called Making Mid-Century Modern. And it has one of those dust covers that I love. It's that matte, slightly scratchy sound. And then the title is slightly raised, and it is glossy. You can probably hear it, although there is a train coming through right now, so you may hear that also. Now, this book is written by Christopher Kennedy. And for those of you that love mid-century modern, it's a nice way to incorporate or get ideas on how to incorporate that style into modern living. And I'll just read the flyleaf for you. So it says, the past is our muse, and the future is our canvas. The celebrated mid-century designers were decidedly forward-thinking. They were using the new technology of the time, plastic, fiberglass, bent wood, and creating shapes that had never been seen before. They were dreamers and futurists that, if alive today, would be creating what's new and not resting on their 60-year-old laurels. Making mid-century modern is created to help you make mid-century modern by offering 100 foolproof ways to introduce modernist design into a contemporary home. The principles in this book are fresh, relevant, and current. What better way to honor the legacy of the mid-century masters than to incorporate their pieces into designs that are distinctly this century? Funny, I grew up with a sunburst. It was a clock. Oh, and there is an example of a swung vase in amber. Again, I just love these sort of inspiration resources. And anything with a pretty picture is going to catch my eye. And I think I actually, we had wallpaper in that exact design in our powder room when we were growing up. So they go through bedroom and the kitchen. And you can see by that shot, that's a very modern kitchen, but he's incorporated some lovely mid-century touches. And some of the color schemes aren't always to my liking, but again, doesn't mean that you can't gain inspiration. So yes, if you are a lover of this era, I highly recommend this book. And a lot of times at secondhand stores or garage sales, you can find gorgeous lamps. The only thing I would suggest is to get them rewired, which you can do. And I love how with each chapter, this page always has a color that is very mid-century. So again, if you don't like the natural, the ecrus and the avocados, there is a color scheme for everyone, or you can incorporate of that mid-century elegance and modernism. So yeah, this has become a go-to for me, and I love just dipping into books like this. And I don't know if you guys do this with coffee table books. When I first get it, I just flip through the pictures. I don't read. And then I dip in again, reading all the descriptions. And not all the furniture from that time period speaks to me. But again, yeah, I don't think you want to like do a theme home, because that might be a bit much. Unless, of course, like some people, they live the vintage lifestyle. Right down to their clothing, cars, squeaky book, to their hairstyles. So again, you can go really vibrant too if you want. Look at those vintage Barbie dolls. Of course, I remember having one very similar to her, with a very distinctive cut crease, the red lips. is. Been a gorgeous find. And if you just look at the front cover shot, what's really funny is that looks very similar to an IKEA bed with the side table. And that's the exact bed that my sister has. Of course, if you're new to my channel, I live with my older sister. So you can incorporate modern pieces with less, or modern pieces that are less expensive, that still have those lines that fit into the aesthetic of a mid-century modern. What I think is kind of amusing, how some of the trends that I grew up with are coming back in style. A slight twist. Carrie's birthday was a few months ago, and our nieces, who are millennials, bought her this gorgeous ceramic pot that is white with some texture, and of course it has a succulent growing in it, but it is housed in a macrame hanger. And Carrie just, I mean, she loves it, it's gorgeous, but she burst out laughing because back in the day when we were their age, before the internet, Netflix, and cell phones, I used to sit around making macrame hangers. So before I let you go and return you back to the present day, I did manage to find a few gorgeous roses from the garden. And again, I have them soaking in a pail of water. If you're ever bringing in flowers from the garden, it's always a good idea to bring out a bucket of lukewarm water, or room temperature water. And as you're cutting your flowers, place them in the bucket and just let them sit there for about an hour before you make your arrangements. And I was just going to warn you, for those of you that maybe don't like spiders, I have done my best to rescue the little travelers that came in. There was no spiders that I saw. A ladybug. But again, if that is your thing that makes you a little uncomfortable, I will do my best to really watch in the editing to make sure that I don't have anybody making an impromptu visit. So let me just adjust the camera angle. I'll go get my swung vase and we'll make a lovely arrangement for the living room. So I did manage to find some beautiful roses that are actually full enough that we can put it in our swung vase. Now, one tip when you are bringing in flowers from the garden is to get a bucket and fill it up with water, and as you're cutting your blooms, immediately place them in the bucket and let them sit there for about an hour. Now, I didn't bring water down to fill the vase. But as soon as I'm done, I'll take this upstairs and give them a drink. And these are very old roses. They date back to the house. So you're looking at, I just said they're very old roses and they're my age. So these are really lovely 51-year-old rose bushes. And because of that, you'll notice that the thorns are quite well developed and sharp. And you can, if you want, remove the thorns when you go to do your arrangement. And until I moved here, I wasn't really a fan, it's a little bit smaller one, of the really deep colors. But I have gained a new appreciation for these gorgeous beauties. The only challenge, maybe a little bit smaller, is to not get caught up in the thorns when you're trying to put the blooms in. And these ones remind me of, because they're red and like a rusty orange. Maybe I could go there. Reminds me of old silk roses. Maybe ones that were made in France. So put this one here. And see how you can use the little gaps. And this one. Remember what I said about the thorns? So let's put that one in the center. And that's, which one's our taller one? This one. We'll go on the back. Thorn out of my thumb. And let's see. I think I might put this one back. Leaves. And let's see if we can maybe do a slightly longer shot. So this is sort of how I would leave it. With me, what I'll do is when I fill this up with water, I'll probably do just a little bit more arranging. But I can imagine this vase also is really great for things like gladiolas, tulips in the spring. So there. A little vintage flower arranging. So gentle viewers, I hope you enjoyed another one of my vintage finds video. And as always, I thank you for spending this time with me. And until we meet again, may you have sweet dreams and a peaceful sleep.